טוב.
I came back from my trip to Phoenix, Arizona last night. And Baruch Hashem, I was there, I don't know, 6 months ago. From the last visit until now, I almost did not recognize the community there. There's so many new Baalei Tshuva, so many new Shomrei Shabbat from the last visit. Baruch Hashem, Bli Ayin Hara, it became so good that they opened a new minyan for the youth. Guys and girls under 20, the place was packed, not enough chair to sit. I told them, get ready to break the walls of the shul, to cut from the parking lot. Guys and girls, teenagers, coming back to Hashem, they grew up in a place, not exactly Yerushalayim there. It's very interesting. Also, you know, something very interesting I found out about Phoenix, that more and more people are moving there. A lot of young couples. Why they move there? Because the government, the state of Arizona, is paying for private schools. They're paying tuition if you want to put your kids in private school, and it's include yeshiva. Wow. So if you have 4, 5, 6 kids, and each one will cost you more than $10,000 a year for yeshiva, here you go. The government pay your entire salary. Nice. Why? People pay taxes. They take the taxes and they help the community. Not like here. You pay school tax and you still have to pay yeshivot separately, where we live. Pay school tax, a lot. We don't use the school, nothing. Baruch Hashem, over there, it's more decency.
You move to Arizona?
Well, someone who has parnasa here is already here. Someone who is afraid is not trusting Hashem to live here, because the bottom line doesn't really matter. Whenever you want, Hashem will support you. Hashem doesn't support people by an amount. He supports people by their needs, what they need to have. It doesn't matter how much it costs. If in China it costs 10% of what it costs in New York, you live there, you get 10%. If you live here, you get 10 times more. See how much people make here, how much they make. People make according to how much they need. It's just a matter of how much you trust Hashem to have enough for food, for clothes, for whatever you need. It doesn't matter. They raise the prices, they lower the prices. It's all nonsense. You should never worry if the gas prices will go up or go down, or rent goes up or goes down. Someone with emunah doesn't care about prices bichlal at all. Not if it goes up, goes down. He only care about that I will find favor is in the eyes of Hashem. Hashem like me, he doesn't see a reason to punish me or to cut my budget or to cut my food or to cut from whatever I need. That's all I have to. The rest doesn't matter. The price is really, it's not important. However, if it's an epidemic, it's a decree, it's called Midat Adin. The judgment is very strict on a place, then we have to worry. Even though we have emunah that individually Hashem takes care of everyone, but if it's a hunger in a land, then there's a reason to worry. Why? Because there's a concept when there is a permission for the Satan to destroy it, everyone suffers from it, even the righteous people with. You understand? Because if the righteous people could not prevent the strike, the epidemic or whatever the problem is, then they suffer with it also. So if there is like America, if America goes bankrupt and people begin to kill each other here on the street, you have to worry. Doesn't matter how righteous you are, you have to worry. If you can run, you run. If you can hide, you hide, of course. Why? You don't count on a miracle. The rule is, when do you count on a miracle? When there's no clear danger in the place where you go. So instead you go to a normal place and then something bad happened, can count on a miracle, yeah. But if you already go to a place that is muad leporanut, it's already known that over there there's lots of crime, war, gunshots, robberies, then if you go to a place like that, you know, then you should know that if nothing happened to you, Hashem takes away from your reward, from your merit. So there's a rule, Shlichei mitzvah enam nizokim. Messenger of mitzvah do not get hurt. They can't get harmed. Why? They're busy with a mitzvah. They're doing something for the sake of heaven. There's special protection. However, we find that there are people who are busy with mitzvah and something happened to them. So the answer in the Gemara is, the Gemara asks this question. Remember, in Judaism, any tricky question that you could ever think about, it was already asked in the Gemara. We're not hiding from questions. It's the only religion that everything is open on the table. Anything. Hard question, easy question, philosophical question, you know, any intimate questions, everything is on the table, everything. So the Gemara say, wait a minute, but we see in reality that people that do mitzvot and in the middle of the mitzvah, they get hurt. So the Gemara say, ha b'shchicha ezeka, ha b'lo shchicha ezeka. Here when there is, the damage is coming, here when the damage is not coming, which means, if a person go to a place that the damage is coming, and he say, well, since I'm busy with mitzvah, nothing can happen to me. No, wrong, my friend. Why? If it's a nature, the nature of the places that people are dying there from sicknesses or from hunger or from all kinds of other problems, violence, whatever there is, if the damage is coming and you enter there, you can get hurt. Even if you're in the middle of mitzvah. Even if you're busy with mitzvah. If you did not get hurt, don't be so happy. You pay the price for it. In your Olam Haba, you see, you got a credit discount from your rewards. One way or the other, you lose. So what's the conclusion? Not to go to places of damage, of danger, of all kinds of other problems. All right, so Baruch Hashem, with Hashem's help, I don't know how, I mean, Hashem helps me all these years, 18 years that I've been giving lectures. But I checked today the numbers. Every month or so, I remember to check the ratings. You know, there's a website. He rates all the websites in the world based on how many people go into your website. You know, so like Google, obviously, it's number one. No wonder the stock is more than $1,000 this week. It's the most popular website in the world. And it's every second millions of people goes in and out. You can't compete with them. But every other normal website in our category, so Baruch Hashem, I got already to such rating that if you ask me that 5-10 years ago, I never believe it's possible. There's already hundreds of thousands of listeners that going to the website every year, you know, and not besides the Facebook, which is even more popular, because Facebook is in and out quickly. It's short articles or short videos. Over here, it's an hour and a half to 2-3 hours each visit. It's a very long visit. So Baruch Hashem, from 5 billion websites in the world, 5 billion websites in the world, it's rated 605,000, which means it's better than 99.999% of the websites in the world. And this is only the lectures that we film. All of you have a share in it. It wouldn't happen without all these activities we do. It's even, there are websites who have 400 speakers, 300, 200, 120 combined. And the rating over here, it's even higher than all of it combined, which hard to believe. It goes to countries you never believe. It goes to Jews. I get emails from Jews. First of all, the names are not Jewish. They already have Goyim name. And they grow up in places, and now all of a sudden, the lectures wake them up. And they realize we're Jewish, the mother is Jewish, or both parents are Jewish, or they move to that place when they're babies, and they're coming back. Not to talk about how many converts and all that, Baruch Hashem. So that's something, you know, to give some boost of energy, Baruch Hashem. The last parasha, Parashat Vayera, mainly about the people of Sodom and Gomorrah, 5 cities of wicked people, just like New York. You have Manhattan, Queens, Brooklyn, Staten Island, and Bronx. Same idea. 5 cities, the center of the world, New York City. And Hashem wants to destroy all of them. And Abraham is arguing with Hashem, maybe you save them. Save these wicked people. Save these wicked people. Why Hashem wants to save them? Because maybe they are righteous people. From the argument, it seems that Avraham really doesn't care so much about the wicked people. He wants to save the righteous people. And the bottom line, the answers that Hashem gives him is not what Avraham is asking. If you really pay attention, you hear hundreds of lectures about it, including I spoke about it in the past. But we don't pay attention to one detail here. Avraham is asking to save the righteous people. And Hashem answered him, if there will be 50 righteous people on those 5 cities, 1 minyan in each place, 10 tzaddikim in each city, I will not destroy the entire place. Abraham said, you're going to kill the righteous people with the wicked people? So Hashem should have said, if there will be 50 righteous people as you requested, I will not touch the 50 righteous people. But that's not what he answered. He said, if there will be, that means I won't touch anyone. Millions of wicked people would survive because they have a kosher minyan in their city, which means Manhattan, I wanted to destroy them, but I don't destroy them. Why? There's 10 righteous Jews there. I want to destroy the Bronx. Oh, but the 10 righteous people there in Riverdale. Okay, so I don't touch it. I want to destroy Brooklyn. Oh, Brooklyn is very righteous people there. I don't touch the place. Do you understand the idea here? In this world, the wicked people celebrate thanks to the righteous people. They eat thanks to them. Everything they have is thanks to them. And what happened in return, as a thank you, they constantly abuse them and complain and embarrass them. And look what happened in Israel. Oh, it's hard to believe. So let's make some orders about some of the things that we saw in this parasha. Because, you know, remember the parasha, every chapter in the Torah, it's mamash a book of law. The problem is most people do not know how to take the laws out of the parasha. That's why we need Chazal, the sages, to do it for us. So it started in the Gemara. It went through the Rishonim until it finally was written in Shulchan Aruch and in a Musar book. But I'll do it for you as we speak. I'll show you how many halachot we learned from this parasha alone. Mamash, it's affecting every moment of our life. Every moment of our life. Because remember, the most important thing in the Torah is to learn how Hashem is thinking. Hashem has his mind. It's not like us. It's much, much higher. Ki lo machshevotai machshevotechem. I don't think like you think. I'm not in your level. Don't expect to understand me. Fine, we know all this. Hashem has his own mind. His own mind is very sophisticated because his mind is taking into consideration trillions of actions, trillions of things. He knows all the history. He knows the future. So many things. When Hashem makes a decision, what's the decisions we make? We know one or two or five details, and we decide. There's hundreds of details we don't know. We gamble. Every decision we make in life, there is some gambling in it. Some gambling in it.
Well, no, we go by majority, right?
But we don't know all the details. We make a decision. We know five details, three against us, two are for us. So we go by the three. But if we knew all the hundreds other, maybe it will change the entire decision, no? How many times in life people ask me questions in the first text? They text a question. I answer them. Then they text another question from the second text. This is detail that they didn't say before. Change the entire answer. Mamash, completely. It's not the answer is not relevant. A minute later. So why when a person asks a question, has to be very smart and clever to tell all the details. The problem with the people that are so ignorant that they do not know which detail relates to the truth or to the lie. They don't know. They don't think that it's relevant. They don't know what's relevant, what's not. This is what I always say. When I made my first film, Divine Information, Informatia Elokit, it was 4 hours lectures. 4 hours. I made it in Israel. The director, the filmmaker, Yuval Ovadia, was a new Baal Tshuva. He didn't know anything from his life yet. He just started to keep mitzvot. So he took 4 hours and he cut 3 hours out of the film. The best parts of the film he cut out. He only focused on few proofs and that's it. Why? He wanted to make the film 1 hour only. It was limited. He didn't want to make a long film. I asked him, why? Why don't you make a long film? You make the whole 4 hours. There's no editing. Just from the beginning to the end. He said people don't have patience to watch. I understood his point, but later I made Torah and Science, which is 4 hours.
Very good
decision. And more than hundreds of thousands watched it in so many languages.
It's like a whole seminar. Means,
yeah, it's a whole seminar. First, who say that they have to watch it in one time? They watch half an hour today, 40 minutes tomorrow. I don't care. Let them watch it in a month. Why do I care? As long as the information is there, like a book. You read 10 pages, tomorrow another 5, the next week another 10, till you finish the book. But at least the information is there. So when, you know, so the same thing people, they call, they don't know what's important, what's not. So sometimes you have to mamash investigate them and ask, like an interview, until you get all the details and you know what to answer. It's very, very difficult. Anyway, so we find something very interesting here. It says like this: the people of Sodom and Gomorrah, in Hebrew, when someone rapes a woman or does all kinds of abuse, sexual abuse, or kids, or any of these things that we hear on the news, unfortunately, every hour, that they call it in Hebrew Ma'ase Sodom.
Act of Sodom.
So even the judges in Israel, when they rule, when they verdict, you know, I mean, the ruling against the criminal, what punishments to give him, so they read Ma'ase Sodom. I promise you, half of them don't even know what it means. They don't know Torah. Ma'ase Sodom. They think it's an expression. Ask the judges if they know what does it mean. Yotze Dofen. Yotze Dofen. It's an expression that means exceptional in Hebrew. But where this expression comes from? In the time of the Gemara, they used to make cesarean surgeries. In the time of the Gemara, the rabbis, they used to open the stomach and take the babies out when there was complication. So the Mishnah say, they're asking if Yotze Dofen needs redemption from the Kohen. If he needs, the father needs to give 5 coins of silver to the Kohen to redeem the firstborn. Why? Because he did not come from the womb. It came from the side, Yotze Dofen. Dofen means side. They open in the side and they take the baby. So this is why 1 out of 1,000 babies needed to go out in such a way. So that's why they call him Yotze Dofen, coming from the side. Then it became in a modern Hebrew an expression of something exceptional, that it's not the rule, an exception to the rule. But people don't know the root of the language. Why? Because they don't know Torah. All right, so let's go back. So it says like this: the people of Sodom, they're all wealthy. Just like Manhattan. $10,000 rent, you know, doorman, all the show off, indoor parking, fancy cars standing under the ground. You know, everyone has a nice job. On my way back from Phoenix, American guy sat next to me. You know, we had a nice conversation, him and I. Very nice person, you know, friendly person, speaks loud. They all plain hear what we speak. Some people, they have a natural microphone in their throat. When they whisper, it's louder than someone who screams. You know, so, you know, his job, the way he is, that's how they like it, they go in. Everything works out, you have accounts, income coming from all over. This is Sodom and Gomorrah. No. So, from all the 5 cities of wicked people, Sodom is the most wicked one. Just like Manhattan. So that's the Manhattan, okay. Then, when the people of Sodom see all the gold and the minerals under the ground, lots of minerals under the ground, under the city of Sodom, it only made them more and more wicked and full of ego and pride. They thought, you know, we are something special. We don't depend on the world. We have everything we need. Okay. So they made a wall. Now no one can come into the city. No one is welcome. This is a VIP club here. You're not welcome. Okay. So what did they do? Actually, they didn't make a wall. They made a hole in the ground, like lakes, that the water will surround the place, that in order for you to come, you need to pass the bridge, and you have to pay tolls. Much like Manhattan. Look, you have to come to the city, you're surrounded with water, exactly like this. And then they cut all the trees that they won't have any fruit. Why? Because it upsets them that the birds enjoy from the fruit. Wow. That's how wicked they became. They were very cruel, even to each other, but mainly to strangers. They don't want any strangers. So they began to kill each other, and of course, it's idol worshiping and stealing. Stealing became a major thing over there. And they nominated only wicked judges. Judges that will do everything to make them happy, okay? And then they make one of the rules: if you help the poor, you have to die. If they find someone who helps the poor, they have to kill him. So there were some people that didn't have anything, they died from starvation because it was against the law to give them charity. Against the law. Right? And not only that, if they saw that they're dying from because they don't have, before they even die, they robbed their homes. They come inside, instead of helping him to support him, they took everything he had, the little that he had. That's how bad they were. Some of them, when the poor person came to beg for food, they gave him a coin. What can he do with the coin? Not money, coin, like a gold coin or something, metal. Because they knew there's nothing he can do with that. As soon as he died, they came and took it. You understand? So when a guest came to the town, they took him to a torture room. They made him lay on a bed. If his legs were longer than the bed, they chopped the legs. If he was too short, there's a machine, they tie his arms and they tie his legs and they roll it, the manuela like this, they roll it and the body stretch, like the Christians, that's what they did to the Jews in inquisitions, in the basements of the churches 500 years ago. That's how they tortured the Jews, by stretching the body until the body rips in the middle. Mamash, the skin begins to rip, then the spine breaks. That's how they used to do to people. Then, if somebody got caught that he has a guest in his house, that person is finished. If somebody accidentally passed through their home, through their town, and somebody did not recognize him, right away they call people, they come, and they robbed him, and they take his bag, whatever he has, they leave him with nothing. Lot, he went there. You know, he left Muncie and he moved to Manhattan. So now when he lives in Manhattan, you know, his daughter, you know, she still have a Muncie education. She went to Bet Yaakov, you know, whatever, Bet Rachel. So now she lives in Manhattan, but she has a good heart. She see a girl, she see a man that is very, very pale and very hungry, that she had mercy on him. So on the next day, on the way to get water from the lake, she hid inside her barrel a piece of bread. When she passed through him, she gave him the bread. Every day she was bringing him a piece of bread that he won't die. One time, people started to think, how this poor person is not dying? Doesn't make sense, he was supposed to be dead by now. So right away they hid to see who is giving him food. And when they found that she gave him food, what did they do? They took her, they put honey on her, and all the bees came and stung her. And then what? Not only that, in the end they burned her. That's how it was. After that incident, the court of heaven, there was a big scream over there. That's it. We cannot tolerate the wickedness of these people. Amar HaKadosh Baruch Hu, Hashem said, their corruption is very, very, it's too much corruption. So it's time to take care of them. So that's when the decree was made to destroy them. But Lot is there. Not that Lot deserved to live. Because from the story of the Torah, we find that once he moved there, that's it. You're one of them. The only problem is that Hashem knows Avraham Avinu will be upset that his nephew will get killed and his daughters. So Hashem sends the angels to save Lot. Lot, as soon as their guests came to his house, right away they see a guest, they take out the guest out. What do they say? Take the guest out, we want to rape them. So Lot say, why? I have two daughters. Take my daughters, why you want to rape them? Take my daughters. I ask, what kind of a normal tzaddik wants to give his daughters to these filthy people just because he has guests in his house? Tell them, listen to the guests, I'm very sorry, look what happened. You'll kill me, what can I do? Forgive me, go save us, go out. What does it mean? He offered himself. They don't want the girls. So some of the Farshim said that he knew that they gays, so he doesn't. So they want anyway. They don't want his daughter. You understand? But what did it help him? Later, they didn't want him. He offered himself. The question is, why would he offer himself? The answer is, he grew up in the house of Avraham Avinu when he saw what Avraham Avinu is doing for the guests. How in the third day of the Brit Milah he ran to search for guests. So it means Avraham cannot live a day without guests. That was already in his genes. This is the education he got. This is the education he got. Okay. It's like you take a Persian person or Bukhari or this kind of culture and tell him, we want to send you guests, but we warn you, do not serve anything to the table. That's the chance that it will happen. Before they walk through the door, half of the supermarket is already on the table. And if you tell this Bukhari or Persian, listen, we're going to, I don't know, throw you out of town, we're going to do something to you, no doubt in my mind, the table has 7 floors of food, will somehow make it to the table. Why? He can't help it. It's in his genes. Why? You tell him not to serve, the guest would sit there, he'll kill himself. I said 20 minutes, and nothing on the table. Right away, food, that. The same thing, Lot. What? You tell Lot, the guest, let the guest die? He can't. Okay. You know, when Lot came with Avraham to Paro, and Avraham said that Sarah, she's his sister. So Lot had an opportunity to say, Avraham, you made a mistake. She's your wife. They'll kill Avraham. Lot take all the money. And Pharaoh takes Sarah. Lot got the millions that he was hoping for, because that's the only way he joined Avraham on the way to Canaan. He didn't know where Avraham is going. He left his town. Why? Let me be next to my uncle in case he dies. An old man. I'll take all the money. Okay. That's by the way Chazal said that Lord has the merit that the Mashiach come from him because he did not say a word in front of Paro. Not because he was willing to die for the guest. Why? Because what he did for the guest, it was in his genes. Yeah, it's mitzvah, but you cannot do any other way. This is the education you got. You cannot do any other way. I give you an example. When you have a Hasidic boy that grew up in a house that they all Shomer Shabbos, to tell him not to be Shomer Shabbos, it's like he doesn't even understand how can it be not to be Shomer Shabbos. What are you talking about? I'll be a goy. What are you talking to me about? Doesn't understand what you want. But to tell him don't speak Lashon Hara may be already much harder for him. Maybe he heard Lashon Hara in his house. You know, since I'm just giving an example. So that's already, if he'll be able not to speak Lashon Hara, even though Shabbos is a much bigger mitzvah than Lashon Hara. Shabbos is the foundation of everything. But since Lashon Hara is very difficult for him not to speak, because he grew up with Lashon Hara, whatever he was, that's why he gets a bigger reward for not speaking Lashon Hara than keeping Shabbat. But someone who grew up in Dizengoff in Tel Aviv, when everyone drives in a car on Shabbat to the beach around him, he gets a huge reward for keeping Shabbat. Why? It's against his genes. He was ready all his life, 30 years, he was Mechalel Shabbat. Now he's sacrificing for the Shabbat. The question is, how Avraham goes in front of Paro, and Avraham said to Paro, she's my sister. So the answer is, twice Avraham did that. It looks like a big mistake. Twice to repeat the same mistake. One time in front of Paro, you saw it didn't work. Same thing you're doing in front of Avimelech. Twice the same mistake. Yeah, first time you did it, if it worked, it worked. It didn't work for you first time. Hashem interfered and saved you. What makes you think that the next time you're going to have the same miracle? But before we're talking about the miracle that saved Avraham, I want to ask you a question. What's better? It's better to go in front of a king and tell him that your wife is your sister and that he will take her, and leave you alive. But you see that a goy, I don't know, what's his name, Obama, he took your wife, and Obama sleep with your wife in his bedroom, and you are alive to see it. What's worse, something like this, or it's better to die not to see it? Better to die. I think normal person, better to die not to see such things. So what Avraham is doing, he's trying to save himself by creating to himself a bigger heartache that his wife would be in the hand of Paro? How can it be such thing? Huh? Did you think about it? Even ordinary person from the street. Ask somebody here with a little yarmulke size of a quarter. Hey, Itzik. Hey, Moshe, come here 1 second. What do you prefer? You prefer to stay alive and see a goy take your wife and live with her in front of your eyes in his bedroom? Or you prefer to die not to see it? At least half would say, I'd rather die than see such thing, no? So what's going on with Abraham? No, you never asked this question? Okay, once. Fine, maybe he was under pressure. What about the second time? With Avimelech, same thing. So what's the answer? No, I have to give an answer for this. What's the answer? Who knows?
Like you said last time, he was hoping that he will send some people and he will talk to these people and convert them. That's the answer?
No. Not in this case. The answer is, the tradition in the world was that in order for someone to take a woman to marry her, he has to buy her from her father. And the father set up the price. Jews, non-Jews, Hebrews, doesn't matter. That's the tradition. And if the father is not there, the brother. There's no father, and she's with her brother. So the brother is in charge. So Abraham says, I'm your brother. Now, if somebody wants her, he's going to come to me and say, okay, we want to buy her. I tell him $500 million, especially when she's the most gorgeous woman in the world. She's a very beautiful woman. You pay me $500 million. And that's exactly what happened. When he came to Egypt, everyone wanted her. Everyone. But everyone wanted her. But when they saw the price, nobody could afford it. That's explained why it says in the parasha that they ran to Paro to tell him that the gorgeous woman came. Why? If a rich guy in the land, a gorgeous woman came to town, he wants her for himself. Well, he runs to the king to tell him, hey, he wants competition? He runs to get her for himself. How much? Quickly. Under the table. How much you want? Nobody could afford. But Paro surprised him. Paro surprised him. There's a law. Paro don't give. The king. The king is above the law. Bring her to me. No, I'm not paying you anything. That's what he wasn't ready for. That's when Hashem interfered and helped him. So it says like this. After Abraham decided to destroy them, it says, "Amechase ani me'Avraham, would I hide such a thing from my servant Abraham?" It's like my partner. So Hashem came to Abraham Avinu now. Okay. And it says, like this. After Avraham, we had all these arguments, and in the end, they came to even Minyan they didn't have. Why they went 50, 40, 30? Why? Because first Avraham say 10 in each city, 5 cities, multiply by 10, 50. Hashem said there's none. Then they say 9 in each, 45. 9 in each. What's 9? You need Minyan. 9 in Hashem. Hashem, with his mercy, will be Asiril Minyan. But they didn't have. So then Avraham gave up on 1 city. So, okay, this city is gone already, so maybe we have 40 now. 4 times 10. None. You understand? And then maybe 30. And until then, even 10 they didn't have. Even 1 city, you cannot save from the 5. Okay, so now Hashem sent 2 angels to Sadom in the evening. Once the sun set, they have to take Lot out. They say, don't look back. Hashem is throwing an atomic bomb. There's radiation here. You don't want problems to have. Don't turn back. Run quickly. So they run. But the wife of Lot turns around. She became a pillar of salt. Some people in Sodom, they take you on a tour. They show you the pillar of salt. This is the Lot's wife. Okay. Velot Yoshev Beshar Sdom. That day that it happened, they make Lot the judge. Why? Up in the beginning, when he came there, he was trying to make Balei Tshuva there, like his uncle Avram. How many Balei Tshuva you can make in Manhattan? It's very difficult. As soon as you give them a lecture, they go up to the bar, go down to the bar, all the work. You came from here, you get out of there. It's very difficult. So when Lot stopped to bother them, they accepted him as one of them. He got his green card. Okay, he got his green card. Later, he got his passport, and now he's a judge. The question is, why they, from all the people in the world, why they took Lot to be their judge? Why Dafka Lot? The answer is, they found out about the story with the shepherds, that the shepherds of Lot had an argument with the shepherds of Avram. So the shepherds of Lot stealing. They take the sheep, and the sheep eats from other people's yards. And the shepherds of Avram say, what are you doing? Our master is very careful not to steal nothing. Why you take the sheep that he gave you as a gift, and everyone knows this is the sheep of Avram, and they go and they eat. You make bad reputation. Chilul Hashem. So what are they saying? Anyway, God promised Abraham the land, no? Say, I'm going to give you the land and to your children. This is the land belongs to Avram already. What difference does it make today or tomorrow? So I gave an example. Imagine now you're going on a contract to buy a house, and the house is a pool. You want to buy the house. So you see it, you negotiate, you send 10% to the lawyer, they do title search on the house. So then your son takes his gang, his friends with their beard and drugs, and they go already there, and they show up in a pool, and everyone jump to the pool, they put loud rap music, and these two people see, what's going on, who are you? Hey, listen, I heard my father is buying this house. It's a negotiation. Anyway, it's my house already. Don't talk too much before I throw you out. What is it? He did not officially become the owner. What are you stealing? But they had an excuse. You know how the thieves are. If they have an excuse, doesn't matter, makes sense, doesn't make sense. As long as they have something to say. So they liked him. Oh, good, you're one of us. You're a sophisticated thief. Welcome to the club. Yeah. You know how Eliezer Eved Avram went there and someone came and hit him and he was bleeding. So he took him to court. And they have a rule. If someone hurt you, you have to pay him. He doesn't pay you. So Lot took the stick and hit the head of the judge. He said, the $1,000 that you owe me, give it to him. This is it. Anyway, so like this, it says like this. The people of, they're attacking the house and they blinded them with mirrors. They blinded them. They come out, the son-in-laws of Lot, they have business. They're supposed to collect rent. They have real estate. So they say, you and your dreams, you what? The city is being destroyed. You really believe it? And they got destroyed. And now, that's how two nations came to the world, Ammon and Moab. Two nations, big nations. Millions of the goyim that you see today in the world came from these nations. Ammon means me'ami, from my nation. Moab means from me'avi, more direct, with no busha. You know, I saw something very interesting. Why Bnot Lot, they never got punished? Or, you know, a daughter wants to have a relation with her own father? Very big sin. Even the goyim is not allowed to do it. It's against the Sheva Mitzvot Bnei Noach. And this is after the time of Noach, so the whole world knows a big sin. Even today the goyim knows it. Nothing changed. So how is it possible that they, because they want to have babies, they allow themselves to be with their father?
They thought the world was destroyed.
Very good. So they thought the world is over. There's no more, because there was no internet, no CNN. You say, there are people in Japan. Okay, we'll move to Japan. No, they thought Hashem destroyed the whole world. So if Hashem destroyed the whole world, we are the three only survivors, and he's an old man with a stick. What's going to happen now? He died, there's no more men. No, that's it. We both died, and the world is, okay, so the world, so who cares? So there's not going to be anyone in the world. But, still give you enough reason to go with your father? So there's not going to be people in the world, ma. I don't understand. What kind of answer is this? It's my responsibility?
What?
Provo applies only to Jews.
Not to Goyim?
You're right. Up to Matan Torah apply to Goyim also. Once Matan Torah, that's in many of the mitzvot, it's only for Jews now. And we didn't find that Hashem punished them. The opposite. Hashem said not to bother them, not to go into war with them. They can convert. Lo titgar bahem. Don't start a war with them. The answer is, when a person is a sinner, it's better to be honest and confess your sin than to be a crook, to cover mechase al peshaav. That's what we say in eslichot. Many people, mechase al peshaav, covering their crimes all the time. That's what they're busy with. They did not cover their crime. They called the kids, this one me'ami, this one me'avi. Now everyone knows these two kids came from Gilui Arayot. And they did not hide the crime. They could have played dumb. Who is your husband? I met him in a club in Manhattan. I don't remember. Before Sodom was destroyed, I had a boyfriend. I was pregnant. And then Hashem destroyed him. So now we don't have husband. Or they could say, we became pregnant from the Holy Spirit. Yeah. Every woman who cheated in those days wasn't only Maria or Mary. It was a very common thing. Because she doesn't want to get executed. So they always say, angel came and made me pregnant. Just one of the story became a legend that everyone knows about. Everyone made that story. So Hashem said, yes, you did something wrong. But at least you're not playing tricks and pretending you're something special. You say to the whole world, as it is, this is what I am. Now, Hashem sent 12,000 angels to destroy Sodom. 12,000 angels. When was that? What date? What date it was? No? What date? Leil HaSeder. 15th of Nisan. And a sunrise. 15th of Nisan in a sunrise. When we finished the matzot, finished the wine, we spoke Divrei Torah all the way to the sunrise. That's when it happened. Esh ve'gofrit. Fire. How do you say gofrit? Gofrit is the things that the matches has on the top. It's powder. Sulfur? Sulfur, yeah, that's the right word. So now the entire place is destroyed. You know, in Israel, if you ever go to Israel, you go to the south, go to Sadom, see the place. Nothing is growing there. It's the most dry place, yes.
Where
in what way?
His daughter's coming to lie with him.
No, he was drunk. That's the whole point.
I read somewhere where they said that when they got up, he was aware of what was going on.
Oh, no. The question is like this. First time, for sure, he wasn't aware. The second night, then the question is in the second night about him. How did he do such thing? None of the three got punished. None of the three got punished here. The opposite, I told you, Lot got rewarded that Mashiach comes from him. Good point. Now, it says like this. Avraham Avinu is a lover of Hashem. Hashem loves him. He gives him test. Avraham passed the test, no problem. When Avraham has the 10 test to take his son to the Akedah, he's 37 years old. But it's not so simple. Why? The Gaon Mivilna doesn't understand how can it be that he's 37 years old. According to the calculation of the Gaon Vilna, he was 27 years old, not 37 years old. And Rivka was 14. Which means 3 years later, when Yitzchak got together with her, right? 3 years later, she was already a woman. So it says like this. Here. Sarah was younger than Abraham in 10 years. 10 years younger. She passed away age 127. When she passed away, Abraham was 137. Abraham was 100 years old when Yitzchak was born. 99 years old he was when Sarah conceived. A year later he was born, he was 100 years old. So now, Yitzchak was 37 years old when his mother passed away. 37 years old. From the time of the burial of Sarah until they buried Abraham, 38 years. Right? Yeah. 38 years. Now, there was one calculation that Rivka, when later becomes the wife of Yitzchak, she was 3 years old. 3 years old. The only problem, when Eliezer came to meet her, some Agada with Aleph. Well, not so clear where this source of it comes from. But it's not possible. Why? Because the story shows that she went to the well and get water, and she gives it to, you know, I mean, so it's not possible that a 3 years old girl was able to do such thing. But according to the calculation of the Gaon Mivilna, she was already 14. Oh, 14 people. Our grandmothers got married at 14 in this generation. So then in those days, no problem. We went to Egypt. Before we received the Torah, Hashem sent us to Egypt. We went to Egypt, and 210 years later, we came out, a whole entire nation. The question is, why we had to go to Egypt? Soon I'm going to connect everything together. Why we had to go to Egypt? What's the excuse? The excuse is like this. In Hasidut books, Sifrei Hasidut, Hasidut is about 200 years old. Something new in Judaism. He didn't have Hasidut 700 years ago. One day there was a Baal Shem Tov. He started a movement. Today, that's what it's called, Hasidut. In the books of the Hasidut, when they speak about Galut Mitzrayim, the going down to the exile in Egypt, they emphasize the main thing of the reason to go to the Galut. What is it? Leotzi misham nitzotzot kdoshim. There are holy sparks in that land. We have to collect those sparks. It's something Kabbalistic. Hasidut and Kabbalah usually goes together. I want to ask you a question. If that's the reason that Hashem sent the whole nation to Egypt to suffer so long there, to collect some of these holy sparks, why Hashem needed them for that? He could have collected those sparks by sending angels to collect them. Doesn't have to send us to suffer so many years in Egypt just because there's some holy sparks over there. Plus, what about other lands? If the sparks spread all over the world, why not to send them every few years to a different country to collect the sparks? Why only to collect it from there? Plus, anybody ever proved that those sparks exist? Is there any source for those sparks? Sparks of holiness. Nitzotzot Kedusha. From where? Why there will be Nitzotzot Kedusha in such a place of wicked people? If Hashem wants to correct the world, he really needs us to do it? if Hashem has problem with his world, he can correct it whatever he wants. He doesn't need us to do it. Like Eov say, Eov was a prophet. What did Eov say? Im chatata matif albo. If you make a sin, what change you make in Hashem's? Hashem is the same Hashem. Verabu pshaecha mata aselo. If you make a lot of intentional crimes, you still did not do anything against Hashem. Im tzadakta mati tenlo. If you're righteous, what did he gain from you? Does it make a difference by who he is? O mami atcha ikach. Or what can he take from you? Does he need anything from you? Leish kamocha. Rish'echa uleven adam tzidkatecha. If you're wicked, it's for you. And if you're righteous, it's for you. Nothing is for Hashem. This is what the Torah says. Leman yetav lach. Everything I gave you, it's for your own benefits. I don't need anything from you. It's for your own benefits. One condition to be belong to the nation of God, you need three conditions. What are they? To join the nation of Hashem, you have to have three conditions, three signs in you to be able to be a part of this nation. What are these? Who knows? Three signs. Avraham Avinu. What's special about Avraham? Talmidav shel Avraham Avinu. The students of Avraham Avinu, what things they have? They have to be merciful, they have to have shame, and they have to be kind, gomle chasadim. Like Avraham, dignity and shame, unlimited kindness, and merciful. Yeah, you care about the cities, that they won't be destroyed. That's why When a goy wants to join the nation of Hashem, you have to see if he has this midot. If he's a cruel person, cannot accept him. If he's very selfish and very egoistic.
How do you check that?
You have to know, you have to ask around, you have to check how he is. Plus, you have to understand this condition. You don't just take someone who comes and declare he is in love with Hashem and say, okay, tomorrow we'll convert you. Doesn't work that way. He has to move to a Jewish community, to be in touch with the rabbi, people begin to see him, they invite him, you know, and then all of a sudden, how long he can hide who he is? How long? Eventually the truth comes out, and then eventually they have to recommend him, somebody sponsor him, it's a whole process. So, only someone who has the three simanim deserves to be a part of this nation. The Jewish nation, you should know, is the only nation in a history that the rabbis, who are in charge of the halakha, of the constitution, needed to design a law to limit the amount of charity that a Jew gives. In any other tradition or nation, you have to encourage the people to do charity, to help, not to be selfish. There, the opposite. People were giving so much that the rabbis came and say, Takana, Be'usha itkinu, in Babylon, 2,000 years ago, they saw even the poor people have nothing to eat. They give everything they have for tzedakah. So they made a decree, you cannot give more than 20% of your income for charity, up to 20%. That applies to ordinary people and to poor people. Someone who's a multi-millionaire, he can give even 90% of his money for tzedakah because he has plenty left. What is he going to do with that? Leave it in Citibank? That Obama will eat it in an emergency war? What is he going to do with that? Hiding it in a safe? Be'usha itkinu shelo yebazbez yoter michomesh. Chomesh means 20%. There's no nation in a history that puts so much highlight and efforts and charity like the Jewish nation. No one in the history. There's no nation that have so many gmachim. Look in Israel, a small state, size of New Jersey. Thousands of funds helping the orphans, helping the widow, helping the poor, helping wounded from the war, helping babies, helping sick people, helping cancer patients. It's unbelievable what's happening. Just in Bnei Brak alone, almost every block has some kind of a gmach. Cribs for people who cannot afford it. Pacifiers for women who cannot buy pacifier for their baby. Car seats. Anything you can imagine. Gowns for brides that cannot afford. Come, just come and take. Sign, return it after the wedding. Everywhere you go. Oh, getting married. You cannot afford blankets, pillows. No problem. Make a phone call. They deliver it to your home. You cannot afford plates, cookware, all that thing. Gmach. You don't have money. Call up the Gmach. I'm in this community. Right away, you come. Here, take a loan with no interest. So the Gemara says, the Jew loves to give so much, to do charity. So the Gemara wrote like this, Nitba'im la'egel ve'notnim. Nitba'im la'mishkan ve'notnim. This is Gemara, Yerushalmi Shkalim. Perek Aleph, first Mishnah. Again, Nitba'im mean you get requested to give. La'egel, what do you mean? They want to make a golden calf. Golden calf. So Aaron said, okay, bring me your jewelry. Right away, not one of them left out. Everyone ran, brought the gold, whatever they have. What do you? Nobody hides. When you let the people give. You hide. Keep your gold for later. They ran to donate. When you tell them, bring to the Mikdash, Bet HaMikdash, HaMishkan, everyone ran to give. Hashem said, no, no, not more than half a shekel. No, no, we want to give more. They want to give. That's why I always say, it's very nice that we have this tray that we want to give. But we have to be clever where to give. Here on my way here, some woman from LA, nice woman, she's Baruch Hashem starting to keep mitzvot, more and more, Shabbat, this, that. So she decided to give some money for CDs. So she gave one or two checks for CDs. On the way here, she sent an email. She said, there is a divorced woman with kids that she doesn't have enough money. So I'm going to start giving them. Is that okay? What's the Torah say? Can compare this to saving souls? Nothing to compare, b'chla. Here you invest in pennies, here you invest in diamonds. So this is what's happening to us. We want to give, but we always give to the last thing in the list. I didn't even go to ask if this woman keeps Shabbat, if she even keeps kosher, probably not. Probably the money she gives her, she'll buy who knows what, non-kosher meat, or who knows what. In the end, it's going to be a sin. But assuming she is a kosher woman, whatever. So it's a nice mitzvah, helping the poor. That's what it is. It's a nice mitzvah. But saving a soul, this is endless mitzvah. It's endless. It's like saving the whole world. Kol ha-matzil nefesh achat. Everyone who saved one soul. I told you the story about Boston. I went to Boston, all the five lectures were packed. And it started from one person, two people actually, one separately. One from New York sent it, and one from Florida sent a CD. Two CDs arrived to Boston and made so many people listening from morning to night now nonstop. You understand what the difference is? The difference between us and Hashem is, I said that once in one of my lectures, Hashem can do trillions of things in a second, it's no problem. He's control of everyone perfectly. We can never do one thing alone at the time, more than one thing. We cannot do more than one thing. But at the same time, the wise scientists of ecology, they state a rule. What's the rule in ecology? A person should know that we can never do only one thing at a time. The opposite of what I just said. I just say we can do maximum one thing, right? Can I write English and French with two hands at the same time? No. Hashem can? Of course he can. He can write thousands of languages at the same time, and each one will be a different story. There's no limitation. But English is English. Now Hebrew, it's Hebrew. That's it. Cannot do both at the same time. Maybe Rav Chaim Oizer was able to do it. And they do the rule, the general rule, a person can focus on one thing at a time. Even when we eat, we can't listen. When you eat, can you listen? Try. Listen to my lecture. And then when you begin to eat, now you 5 minutes it took you to eat your sandwich, see if you can repeat the last 5 minutes anything. Yeah, you hear, but you don't listen. Because your mind is already in the food now. Or if somebody walks through the door every second. When you leave that lecture, you did not get one thing from the lecture. Why? Because you're constantly looking at the door like this. That's why one of the rules is that a person that wants to learn seriously never look at the door. Doesn't care who walks in, who walks out. The door is out of hear noises around, people, oh, hey, Moshe. The world doesn't exist. I told you about Rav Ovadia. Benjamin Netanyahu stood half an hour with his bodyguards one step away from his chair, and he didn't realize he's in a room. Half an hour until he looked that he's there, he got up. Wow. Nobody can disturb him. No one. First 5 minutes, they testify. When you begin, you can disturb him. After 5 minutes, that's it. You shoot in a machine gun, he's not there. It's just like when a person goes to sleep. From the minute he puts his head, he begins to fall asleep. First 5 minutes, it can disturb him. Once you begin to hear him snoring, it will be very difficult. He's already in a deep sleep. So they say, the ecology scientists, they say, "Le'olam einenu yecholim la'asot davar echad bilvad." Who wrote it? Francis Thompson. He passed away 1907. So that was written by Francis from England, a famous figure about ecology, he says. That they said that you can never do one thing only. So there's no contradiction, don't worry. The answer is, when I say we cannot do more than one thing at a time, meaning I do one thing and then a minute later I do something else. I cannot do both of them at the same time. Nobody can argue with that. It's a fact. But just when I think that I do one thing, I actually affected the entire world. The entire world. At the time that I'm doing something in the world, even standing outside smoking a cigarette and spreading smoke, it's already affecting the entire creation. Even spilling some garbage on the sand, and it goes inside, and it goes all the way to spring water, and later it goes to people's faucet, whatever. It's changing the whole world. It's the butterfly effect. He moves over here, he can create a typhoon in China. People are dying. It started right here in New York. The butterfly went like this. 1 million Chinese are hiding now in shelters. Yes, not a joke. It's scientifically proven. The effect... That is everything that we do, yeah, one thing at a time, but it is affecting the whole world. There's one more thing we have to know. All the good things in life, Hashem made a rule in the creation, come through suffering. Eretz Israel, you want to move to Israel. How much you have to suffer until you settle in Israel? Even if you took $100 million with you cash, still have to suffer from day to night for at least 2 years till you merge into the environment and the life there and all that. Schools for the children, shul that you like, neighborhoods that your wife will like or you like, work, business, meeting people. But it's not just to move to Europe, oh, 1, 2, 3, and you're there. No. In Israel, special difficulty. Why? You want to move to the most important place in the world on a picnic? piece of cake? No, my friend. Everything good, Hashem made a rule. Chayav lavo b'isurim. Torah. You want to be a big Talmid Chacham. Did you ever see a Talmid Chacham who smoke his pipe and has a nice bow tie and a $50,000 watch and he sits in a library like this 2 hours a day and he became Rav Ovadia Yosef? Never going to see such thing. No, maybe he'll be a professor in the university. Maybe. Nobody. You want to be Talmid Chacham? 6 years, sweating, freezing, food, no food. The brain is smoking. One day you become Rav Eliashiv. Every other rabbi compared to these big ones is like comparing a monkey to a person. It's nothing to compare with that. Take the best speaker in the world, put him on a scale next to Rav Ovadia Yosef, put 5,000 speakers with all the beautiful knowledge, put them on one side of the scale. You put them on the other side, the scale will break to his side. Machria et kulam. So it's a whole different league. How you become like this? You give every inch of your sweat, every inch of your energy, everything in your life for this. Without it, you cannot become. Pat b'melach tochal, bread with water, that's it. If that's my food all my life, fine. I'm willing to do it. If they come to us now and say, oh, Mr. X, you want to be Chacham Ovadia Yosef, the new one? Okay, we have a list of conditions. No, okay, tell me the list of conditions. Pirkei Avot. Listen to my Pirkei Avot series, it's right there. Pat b'melach tochal. All your life, bread with salt. Stale bread. Not from the bakery, Bukharian bread like this. Ah, crunchy, delicious. Yeah, even the Ashkenazim in Borough Park began to eat Bukharian bread. Someone in Phoenix told me. He said that his friend opened that bakery in Borough Park. He thought, are you crazy? They eat challahs. The Ashkenazi, Bukharian bread. So I asked him, no, how did he do? He said, gold mine. No, my friend, stale bread, hard like a rock, with some salt. You ready all your life? Yes. V, check. Check, you know, they go to the doctor, give 50,000 questions. This, that, your gums bleed, you have this symptom, you have that. 5,000 questions. By the time you finish it, you already come to the next visit with a cane. 30 years to fill up the application. All right. Next thing, water you drink like a dog. Not today, we have faucet, Baruch Hashem. You make a hole in the ground, the water are brown, like in India. You know, you drink it. You choke. Why sand? No complaint. We have to learn Torah, no time to waste. Like Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai. Water from the lake, carobs from the tree, 13 years. Simple life, bed, no bed, there is a place to sleep. Rav Shach slept when he was 16, 3 years in yeshiva in Russia on the floor, on a marble floor, not marble, stone. There was no mattress. You know the story, no? There was no mattress. Then he got a letter from his uncle that doesn't have kids and is a very rich person. I need someone to take over the factory. Come over, there's also a shul over here, you can learn Torah here, and I'll teach you the business, and you take over. Millions of dollars for a little boy. His uncle is old. So, not that he cared about the money so much, but he looked the way he lives in yeshiva, he doesn't even have a mattress, he was very poor. So he said, okay, I'll move. So he packed the bag, he said goodbye. On the way out, a widow came with a mattress. He said, my husband just died, and today we finished the Shiva. We said 7 days Shiva. And I have an extra mattress, and I heard in this yeshiva, the people who don't have a mattress, so I want to donate the mattress. So he looks at her, and he has a bag on the way to the train. He has a ticket to the train his uncle sent him. So I ask her, she asked him, do you have, young boy, do you have a mattress? He said, no, for 3 years I didn't have a mattress. So here, I'm giving it to you as a gift. She gave him the mattress. Was 16 years old. Eliezer Man Shach, the boy. Most of the boys today, after they suffer enough, they say, too little, too late, like they say in America. Too little, too late, ma'am. Where were you 3 years ago when my back broke? Now, go inside, you find somebody already, give it to him. I'm already on the way to Beverly Hills. You know? I have a train ticket. But Rav Shach wasn't like us losers. We would continue to the train. I have plans, Rabbi. I made plans. I have a birthday party. How can I come to a shiur? Birthday party of who? The uncle of the cousin of your neighbor. Birthday party. What do you care about this? Oh, there's a good cake over there with some candles. You sing Yom Huledet. Huh? Losing 2 hours lecture. 120,000 mitzvot to go clap for Johnny. His birthday today. Baruch Hashem. No, right or wrong? I'm not talking about the fools who take a plane and they fly from one side of America to the other to a birthday of their brother or something like that. Why are you going to New York? My brother tomorrow has a birthday. No? So call him, send him a nice email. Taking off from work. Beautiful. So Rav Shach went back, and the rest is history. He became the most important person in the world. Lived 107 years. Everything that comes from suffering, everything good has to come from suffering. Torah, suffering. Eretz Israel, suffering. What else? Olam Haba. You want to get your ticket for the afterlife? How much you have to break your desire one day after the other. Yeah, people think they're in a picnic here. Yeah, chol v'shato ki machar namut. Eat and drink and enjoy the moment. Be healthy. You know? You want to get the ticket, my friend? How many gets the ticket in the end? Few, very few. Has to be a lot of effort. Avraham Avinu made a Brit Milah, and the third day, it's the hardest day. After the circumcision, first day it's hard, second day it's hard, third day it's the hardest. Then it begins to heal. Third day, critical. So Avraham Avinu, in the third day, when he's in such condition, instead of laying in bed, he has servants that can take care of him. He sits outside, Petach HaOel, in the entrance to his tent. Avraham Avinu, before he was circumcised, when he arrived to Canaan, Canaan is the most important city in the world, that's Eretz Israel. He made fun at all the Canaanim, the Goyim. Why he made fun at them? For them worshipping idols. Hey, Mustafa, you fool, why you bow down to this idol? That's how Avraham was, making fun at them. By the way, it's mitzvah to make fun and idol worshippers. Did you know that? When Hashem says, never insult any person, never offend a person, even a goy. Not only Jews, not only your brothers, not strangers, no one. You're not allowed to offend any person. You have to respect every person. You have to give him his kavod. Unless if it's an idol worshiper. If it's an idol worshiper, not only you don't have to give him any respect, mitzvah to put him down. Mitzvah to laugh at him. Mitzvah to make jokes at him. Mitzvah to speak Lashon Hara at him. Mitzvah, everything turned around. Idol worshippers. And there are many Jews who are also idol worshippers. I'm Evin Yavin. Yes? Well, from here, it's a very good question what you ask, but from here it's mashma all the time, because Avraham made fun of them all the time, not only when they, in general, okay. So it's saying, because even the Mechalel Shabbat, right? The restriction against him applies all the time, not only when he's Mechalel Shabbat, even on Monday. He wants to come and be a part of the Minyan on Monday for Mincha. You have 9 and he's the 10th. You cannot say Kaddish. You need 10 Shomrei Shabbat. Okay. So, Avraham makes laugh at them. Nobody touched him. How can it be? When he was 75, Hashem said, go. He went to Canaan. Now he had a kid. He's 100. He's more than 20 years in Canaan already. He make fun of them for more than 20 years. They didn't touch him. Try to go now to Egypt and make fun at some Mustafa or Ahmed. Before you open your mouth and finish the sentence, your head will be soccer ball. What do you think? That's even if you don't open your mouth. I see you with the yarmulke, you're finished. But Avraham is a guest there. He came there. Nobody make a beep. He laughs at them in their face. Think about it. Why I'm telling you this? Why? Avraham is a billionaire. In our comparison to today, he's a very wealthy person. He has hundreds of camels, cows, thousands of goats, 318 servants. Yeah, so you see right away a heavy person. Avraham kaved b'mikneh uvatzon. Oh, in the old days, you see the wealth. The wealth goes with you everywhere. It's not like today. Everything is in a bank, and you can come pretend, you know, can you help me? Can you spare some change? It's $100 million he has. He pretends he's homeless. And then Avraham, where is he going to hide his wealth? There's no bank, no safes, no wire, no... It all comes with him, and it keeps growing every year. It's more and more and more. So it says like this. He's a hero. Everyone knows he went to the war against the kings, and he saved Lot. He has miracles that God is doing for him. Nimrod threw him to the fire. He was in jail 13 years by Nimrod. And in the end, they threw him to the fire, and he didn't get burned. He has already a very big reputation, Avraham. So the Canaanim are afraid of him. Nobody makes a beep. They know he has already a history. And he knows how to fight. He's a strong hero. He already proved himself fighting against five kings. Five kings. One person with a group of 318 people against five nations. It's not a joke. Just the Maccabim against the Greeks. What was the odds that a group of Maccabim will win the Greek Empire? Avraham has a reputation. Hashem said to Avraham to make Brit Milah on the day. Cannot circumcise at night. You can. You have to circumcise the baby only when it's light outside. Be'etzem hayom. In the middle of the day, Avraham make the Brit Milah. When it's sunny, everyone will... Well, what's the difference? Why Hashem care if the Brit Milah will be in the day or at night? And if it's at night, you cannot do it? The simple answer is, today we have electric. You can see it at night just like you see in a day. In the old days, what are you going to bring? Torches, you cannot see, you cut by the wrong place. Very hard, it's dangerous. You don't do surgery at night when you don't have enough light. That's the simple answer, but there's a much better answer than that. What's the answer? Hashem wanted everyone to know that Avraham was circumcised and he's sick. He had a surgery. When you have a surgery, you're unable to fight. Everyone knows for the next week, you're unable to do anything. If he would circumcise him at night, the goyim would say, we didn't know. How are we supposed to know? But in a day, everyone see. Oh, he circumcised all his kids, all the servants. It was a big thing. And nobody made a beep. Hashem wanted the whole world to know in history, even when Avraham was disabled, nobody was able to come near him. Why? He has a special protection from Hashem. The goyim could not say, oh, if we would know, of course we would fight him. Why? Because they knew. This is the Rav Yonatan Eifshit said it 200 years ago he lived. Just before we finish, we have 10 more minutes left. We read in the parasha, Vayi achar hadvarim ha'ele v'ha'elokim nisa et Avraham. Vayi achar hadvarim ha'ele. And after those things, what's those things? In the written Torah, it doesn't say. You want to know what? What's the rule? You go to the oral Torah, right? You go to the oral Torah, what does it say? Achar dvarav shel Satan. After the words of the Satan. What's the word of the Satan? The Satan came to God and say, Zaken zechananto lemea b'fri beten. This old man, you gave him a gift, a child, when he's 100 years old. It's against the law of nature, right? Okay. והנה ערך משתה גדול, he made a huge party, ומכל הסעודה שהכין, and all these beautiful fancy meals that he made, לא הקריב לך דבר, he did not make one sacrifice for you. And Noah came from the ark, first thing he did, he took 7 kosher animals and sacrificed them, okay. Not even a bird, like the poor people. The poor people cannot afford a goat, so they bring a little bird, dove. השיב לו הקדוש ברוך הוא, השם said, ראו תראה כי אם אומר לו זבח את בנך לפניי מיד זופחו. You don't know him. If I would tell him now this boy that you waited 100 years for him, sacrifice him for me, in a second he'll do it with no hesitation. Hashem said to the Satan. And right after that, ויהי אחר הדברים האלה והאלוקים נישא את אברהם. That the Satan will not have what to claim against Avram. Nisa means nisayon, test. But we have a say in Hebrew, Nisa means also to rise a person. You should know in life, like, life is like this. This is the way life design. Every test you have, you passed it, your level automatically goes to a new rating. Every tragedy, every lost, every hard effort, everything that builds your character, besides building your character and make you more stronger for life, it's automatically elevating you in the spiritual level, higher and higher and higher and higher and higher. Just like the Rav Sdeh Chemed, Rabbi Chizkiya Medini, he was in yeshiva and he had one enemy who was jealous with him. Jealous guy. But he wasn't special. He wasn't any special learner. He was just an ordinary student. But his enemy, for whatever reason, couldn't stand him. There was an Arab cleaning lady there in yeshiva. And he bribed her, gave her some money. He said, tomorrow I want you to come to the chief rabbi, and say that this Chizkiya, or young kids, young teenagers, Chizkiya is, you know, touching you, is doing things with you. Here is the money. So she came. She did what she did. Everyone in yeshiva were shocked. So what happened? The rabbi said to him, listen, I believe you innocent. I know who you are, but it doesn't matter what I believe. It's already in the rumor in town. I suggest you leave town. When everyone will forget, I'll send someone to tell you when it's the time to come back. He left town. He was already in a different town for months. This Arab lady eventually, she felt that it was bothering her. You know, the money is gone. Now she begins, her conscience begins to bother her. How did I destroy this innocent kid? So she started to ask around. They told her where he is. So she went to his place. She knocked on the door. He opened the door. And she told him, I came to ask from you to forgive me. What did I do? It's this guy gave me money, bribed me. I'm sorry, forgive me. Okay. So she say, I'm willing to come and testify in front of the whole yeshiva that he's the one who did it for you. And you can return back right away. But I just want you to promise me one thing, that you talk to the rabbi, not that I won't lose my job after that. To ask him, because I'm making tshuva, I repent, to keep me in my job. I don't have a job. So he say, okay, no problem, I'll talk to the rabbi. He start to pack his stuff. Just when they're about to leave the door, he started to think. So he said, what will I gain by going back? Now I'm going to go back in front of the whole yeshiva. This goya is going to stand and point at this guy. And again, the whole town, for 1 month, everyone will speak Lashon Hara. Until now, it was about me. Now it will be about another person and support him and against him and against me and machloket again. What will I gain? My reputation will get clean. I don't care about my reputation. It's ruined already. I paid the price. So he told her, go back, go back. I'm not coming with you. She said, what? What happened? So I decided I don't want. I'll stay here for the rest of my life, no problem. And he wrote in his book that that moment changed his entire life. After she left, until that moment, everything was learning. It was hard for him to remember. He couldn't remember. He couldn't understand deeply inside. From this moment on, Hashem opened up his brain and he became one of the greatest rabbi in history. There's not one yeshiva without his books. Sdech Emet, very big posek, very big chacham. So what do we see? One major test can change your entire future. Look at Lot. Why Mashiach come from him? 1 minute test in front of Paro. 1 minute test. All he had to say, Avraham, you made a mistake. Sarah is your wife. End of story. So Avraham circumcised Ishmael. He's 13 years old. And Yitzchak, 8 days old. Later they grow up. Ishmael come and say, he said to Yitzchak, before Ishmael, before they grew up, after Hashem said to the Satan, I bet you if I'm going to tell him to sacrifice my son, his only son after he waited 100 years, right away he will do it. And that's when Hashem tested Avraham, and Avraham agreed right away. So Hashem said to him, Kach na et bincha yechidcha asher avta et Yitzchak. Velech lecha el har Moriah, al achad harim asher omar elecha. Okay. So he said to him, this is what we read in the Torah. We have to go to the Midrash to know really what happened there. Without the oral Torah, there's no understanding in any subject, nothing. So Hashem said to Avraham, Kach na et bincha, take your son. So Avraham answered, which son? I have two. One Yitzchak, one Ishmael. So Avraham said, Hashem said to Avraham, Yechidcha, your only one. Which means you don't have two. You have only one son. It's in the Torah. Yechidcha, take your son. This is, by the way, a proof for all the Arabs and for all the Goyim, that the only son of God is Yitzchak. Nothing to do with Ishmael. Why? It's a verse in the Torah. Take your son, your only son. What do you mean? Right before that, it said that he have a son from Agar, the Arab. The Arabs are not the children of Hashem. End of story. You can make a lot of noise in the world. It's a verse in a book that they admit that it's the book of God. What is it? Politics, United Nations. This garbage. There's a verse in the Torah. Right? Stand in the United Nations. Ladies and gentlemen, stupid words. I have a sentence to read to you from the book of God. God come to Abraham. You know him? Abraham. Ibrahim. What did he say? Take your son, your only son. And you all know that Ishmael was alive. The opposite. He was the older. He's 13 and there's a baby. Who's more important? You have two sons, two Jews. 13 and 8. Who comes first in the Torah? The 13. Why Hashem treat him like he's nothing?
Because he's nothing.
Very simple. What do you need? You need a specialist to explain it to you? So Hashem said to him, Yachidcha. Yachid, echad means one. Even in Arabic it means one. Wahad. So they say, oh, we don't believe in this word. In Arabic, echad wachad. They steal all the words from Hebrew. Echad wachad. So it's no problem. Yechidcha, it's in Arabic also. Your only son. So Avraham continued to argue. He said, well, I have two. He said, Asher avta, the one you love. So Avraham answered, I love both of them. Avraham said. Then Hashem said, et Yitzchak. Yitzchak, one Arab told me that when I asked him that, why don't you read in the Torah? So he said, ah, you the Jews changed the Torah. It was really Ishmael and you made it Yitzchak. So I said to him, the Torah is 2,000 years before your Quran. There's no Quran. 2,000 years there was Torah all over the world. There was no communication, no internet, no telephones, no mail, no FedEx, no international, none of these things. There are Jews all over the world. Afghanistan, Iran, Poland, Russia, Yemen, Israel, Syria. All over the world, they scattered in every city, in every world the Jews are. And they don't know about each other because they spread all over. And they copy the Torah manually. One copy, one here, there, Poland, Russia, Syria, they all copy Torah. Show me one Torah from millions of Torah that was written in the last 3,300 years. One! Forget about the majority. One copy in a history that was ever found that it said Ishmael was the one. How did the Jews all over the world know to alter the Torah exactly all over the world without making one letter mistake? What kind of a fool is that? Such a stupid claim. Even a retarded person won't make a claim like this. But that's what they teach. That's what they teach. I'm wondering why the Arab students don't raise their hand and say, excuse me, Mustafa, what are you telling me? That how the Jews one day woke up and they all knew to change the Torah exactly the same all over the world, even though there was no communication between them? Plus, do you have a record of one Torah that it says like this? We never found two versions to the Torah. End of story. What's the argument here? Et Yitzchak, take Yitzchak. And then later it says in the Torah, Beitzchak, Yikare lecha Zara. In Yitzchak will be your descendants. What about Ishmael? Nothing. The law, by the way, Abba min Goya karu ibna. Someone who come from the Goya is considered to be her son, not your son. It's not your son. You have nothing to do with him. Nothing whatsoever. Later, the kids are growing. Ishmael and Yitzchak, they argue. They say, when our father passed away, Ishmael say, Ani irash et kol ha'olam. I will occupy the whole world. Why? I'm Bechor. I'm the oldest son. I'm supposed to get more than you, he said to Yitzchak. Yitzchak say, you're Bechor in years, in age. But I am coming in front of you when it comes to Hashem. Why? I was circumcised, as Hashem said, when I was 8 days old, right away. And you only when you were men already. Okay. Ishmael say, the opposite. That's a proof that I'm better than you. You were circumcised when you could not protest. Nobody asked you. I participated in the circumcision. I could have run away. I said, leave me alone. I don't want a surgery now. I'm 13 years old. You want to circumcise? Circumcise yourself. Right? That's a very good point, no? Now you understand why the Palestinian politician, they know how to talk nice in CNN and lie to the whole world every day. When the Israeli always lose the arguments, somehow. They have their justice, but they always lose when it comes to mouth. Like Iran, look how they fool the whole world.
Lives.
Yeah. It's, so Ishmael, so far, he has a good point. Say, Yishiv lo Yitzchak. Yitzchak said to him, how much blood you gave to Hashem? 3 drops? When you're old, it's not like a baby. It's different. In the beginning, it says like this. He said to him, the argument was when Yitzchak was 37 years old. So Yitzchak said to him, if Hashem would want me to sacrifice all my blood for him, not 3 drops like you, I'm willing to do it. That's right before Hashem said to Abraham to take Yitzchak to the Akedah. This is the conversation. Amar HaKadosh Baruch Hu LaMalachim, Hare Lifnechem Sichat Bnei Avraham. You all heard the conversation of the sons of Avraham, no? Here. Okay. Now it's the time to see if Yitzchak will keep his word. So already we have 2 reasons for the Akedah. One is the Satan came in front of Hashem, say he couldn't sacrifice anything for you. Hashem say, if I tell him, he'll sacrifice the whole thing for me, his only son. Even though I told him all the years, tell the Goyim not to sacrifice their babies. The Goyim, they were not killing their babies, but they take the babies in a fire. It's called Noten Mizaro LaMolech. There's a restriction in the Taryag Mitzvot, 630 Mitzvot. Lo Titen Mizarachal LaMolech. They used to take, they make fire. They believe that by putting the fire inside the babies inside the fire like this, it makes him healthier and stronger for life. Such nonsense, but you know. So Hashem said to them, later they started to kill some of these babies. So Hashem said to Abraham, tell them that I'm not interested in this. Now against what he told him, he said, take your son and kill him for me. Well, Abraham should have said to him, what do you mean? It's against your truth. You don't want innocent babies to be sacrificed. He didn't make a beep.
But he didn't actually say sacrifice, did he?
He said, "Kach ne'ed bincha yechidcha asher ahavta, ve'lech lecha zeh, ve'alehu sham le'ola." Alehu le'ola means bring him up as a korban ola. Sure, sacrifice. So, this is, by the way, why we say, "Al tiftach pe la'satan." Many times people say, if I'm going to do this and this and that, I'm willing to do this and this and that. If this and this would happen, I'm going to do da, 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 da. Don't talk. Because Hashem right away puts it into a test. Why do you talk so much? If this will happen, I will never come again. If this would happen, I will come every day. Well, then Hashem says, oh yeah, good, I'm interested that you'll do it every day. Right away puts you in this nisayon. This is David HaMelech. David HaMelech said to Hashem, I want to be the fourth wheel of your carriage. Some Kabbalistic, metaphoric words. That there is a chair of Hashem, and there's also a carriage. It's all metaphoric. Don't start getting fooled by this. It's not reality that there's really a carriage. Hashem doesn't have an image. He doesn't need a chair to lean back, maybe he has back pain. Doesn't need a chair. Just all metaphoric. It's a spiritual conversation here. So it says, David HaMelech said to Hashem, Avraham, Yitzchak, and Yaakov are already three wheels of the carriage. I want to be the fourth wheel. So Hashem said to him, you can't. So he said, why? I'm not righteous enough for you. I give my life for you. And it's true. So Hashem said, no, you're good. You're righteous. But they had a test and they passed the test. You didn't have any substantial test yet. So David said to Hashem, test me. So right away the Torah say, right after this, he said, test me. He saw Bathsheba on the roof of a building, gorgeous woman standing on the roof. And from that, his mistake came. After with Uriah Hiti. So what do you see? A person say, test me. He doesn't know what he's asking for. The opposite. We pray every morning, Ve'al tevienu le'eden nisayon. Better you don't test me. Why? I know I'm a loser. Why? You test me, I'm going to fail. You test me again, I'll fail again. Do me a favor, don't test me. You know? Don't be a hero. Big shot. The interesting thing is that Avraham did not wait for the evening to do it. Vayashkem Avraham baboker. One thing, he was able to sleep. I have a flight, I cannot sleep all night. Every hour. You know, not to miss the flight. It's going to affect my entire schedule. One delay, finish, you're stuck. One thing leads to another. Everything has to get canceled and reorganized. Can't afford any mistake. From the being nervous, not to miss the flight, this, that. Avraham, he supposed 100 years he waited for a kid. What happened now? He's running at 5 in the morning to slaughter him. What? Keep him until 8 in the evening, 7 in the evening. All the family come, all the Bukharians, the Persians, they dance, they hug him, they bring some good food. No, they slaughter a lamb, a goat, shish kebab, everyone comes, say goodbye, Yitzchak Motek, we're going to miss you. No, a kid goes to the army in Israel, 1 month parties. Party, the friends, the family, the neighbors, the uncle, the grandfather, everyone say goodbye, like he goes to Siberia or something. Then he goes to the army, the next day come 4 o'clock in the afternoon. There's some officer, a receptionist in an office in Tel Aviv. Not everyone goes to a war. But already they, we'll miss you, we'll never see you again. So what's the rush to kill Yitzchak after 100 years? This is an amazing thing. Vayashkem Avraham baboker. Yashkem means sunrise. Soon as the light comes, he's running already to do the mitzvah. That's, by the way, the reason why if you have a brit to your son and you have a dilemma to do it early in the morning in shul, when 90% of your guests are far away and they won't make it, or to wait for the afternoon that all the guests would show and make something big? The answer is you do it early in the morning with a small group, then waiting for the afternoon to do it with a larger group. Why? The rule, zrizim makdimim la mitzvot. A real tzaddik is fast to do the mitzvot. It's not delayed. At the same time, we have a mitzvah, berov am adrat melech. When you do a mitzvah in public with a large quantity of people, it's considered higher than a small group. So it's contradiction between two laws. One law now is colliding with the other. That's why we need the Torah to tell us which one is heavier. Zrizim makdimim la mitzvot o berov am adrat melech. It's a big question. Chacham Ovadia has a whole answer about it in Yabi HaOmer. It's a whole answer about this question. Proving how do we know that this is more important. The answer, conclusion, better early in the morning with less guests. The guest wants to come to the brit, let them sleep over. No problem. Just mamash before we end, it says like this. When Sarah found out she's going to have a kid, she's 90 years old. So they told her, next year, Ka'et Chaya, and this time next year, you already have a baby. You'll have a baby. So Sarah was laughing. Lama tzachaka Sarah, there's a song in Hebrew from the 1960s. Lama tzachaka Sarah, why Sarah was laughing? But what's the, but I don't understand, Avraham was also laughing. So why Hashem got upset with Sarah that she's laughing? Avraham also laughed. No, we don't find anything that Hashem said why Avraham is laughing. Plus, Sarah was laughing because her husband is old. Ve'adoni zaken. Hashem comes to Avraham, he didn't tell him that part. He doesn't want to instigate between husband and wife. Hashem always wants peace and harmony in a family. So Hashem changed the language. He said, why Sarah say that she cannot have kids because she's old? That's not what she said. She said, because my man is old. And plus, there's another problem here. We all know that a man has no limitation having kids, even when he's 80. He can still have kids. The time is ticking against the women, not against the men. Man is not nervous. Man is worried, by the time I have kids, I'm going to already come to the bar mitzvah and with someone holding my hand. He's embarrassed. I want to see my kids getting married when I'm young, not when I can hardly see. You know, but women has a much more stress because once they get to a certain age, they already begin to understand, well, another year, another five, that's it, I won't be able to have kids. So what's the problem? Sarah say, Adoni Zaken. She is the problem. She should have said, how can I be have kids? I don't have a period anymore. Chadal liot le-Sarah orach kanashim. Sarah doesn't have a period, that's it, menopause. End of story, there's no chance to be pregnant. So what is she complaining about Avraham? No, what's the answer? You learn Torah, learn. 20 years, you hear the same. You read and nobody asks these questions. Ah, Emil, wake up. Good question or no? Plus, we have to understand why HaKadosh Baruch Hu changed the words of Sarah. What, Hashem is lying? So you say, oh, for the sake of peace, Hashem wanted to teach us that you're allowed to lie. It's true. Somebody asks you, tell me, how is my wife? Is she pretty? And she's very ugly. You have to say, the Gemara say, you have to say, Kala na'a v'chasuda, beautiful bride. Everyone asks, but Hashem say, midvar sheker tirchak, you're not allowed to lie, stay away from lies. So the Gemara say, sheker l'shem shalom, lie for the sake of peace is mitzvah. It's allowed. So that's the rule. But Hashem didn't need to lie. All he had to do is to say, why Sarah is laughing that she doesn't believe that I can give you a kid? I wouldn't lie. Why he has to change the word? Especially when the stamp of Hashem What's the signature of God? Emet. Chotamo shel HaKadosh Baruch Hu Emet. If there is a way not to instigate between husband and wife without lying, of course, that's much better. Don't need to lie. I don't have to tell her what, I don't have to tell him what his wife say about him. Why my wife was laughing, Rabbi? Why was she crying? What did she say to you about me? You don't have to lie. You just don't tell him what she said. That's it. If she say good things, it's only the good things. Right? There's a way without lying. It's, of course it's better. So you can answer, no, no. But Hashem wanted us to learn that also to lie you allowed if there's no choice. That's not. If he would only just not say it, it's not considered a lie. He's just holding information. That's not a lie. But Hashem wanted us to know that even to go one step further, for the sake of peace, you're allowed to lie. But I want to tell you something. You should know, in case you have a doubt, there was a king named Ahav, and his wife was Izebel, a very wicked woman. And they were greedy. They were very rich. They, the king and the queen. And there was a person, his name was Navot HaYisraeli. Navot. And he had a vineyard, nice vineyard. And their eye was on this vineyard. They want it. So Izebel instigate that they will, Ahav will kill him. Not only they'll kill him, they'll take away his vineyard. That's what they did. They murdered him and they took his vineyard. Then he went up to heaven. He was sentenced to go to heaven. Who? This Navot. So it means he was a righteous person. Then Hashem say, listen good, it's amazing. It's appear in the book of Kings, A, chapter 22, verse 20 to 22. That's the source. What does it say? It says like this. Amar HaKadosh Baruch Hu, Hashem said, Mi yefatenu et Achav? Who is going to trap Achav? To put a trap in front of this wicked king Achav? Ve'yatza ruach, and the spirit stood in front of Hashem. Vayomer, ani afatenu, I'm going to volunteer to do it. Vayomer Hashem elav, Hashem said to the spirit of this Navot, Bema, what's your plan? How are you going to put him in a trap? He say, Etzev ha'iti ruach sheker befi neviav. I will enter the mouth of the prophets of his generation and give him false information. Right? That he will die because of it. Vayomer, tefate gam tuchal tzeve haseken. Hashem said to him, put a trap in front of him. You'll be successful. Tzeve haseken. Go out and do so. Which means Hashem is... guarantee, it's personal guarantee. Oh, he sends him to lie. Hashem say, yeah, go lie, put a trap for him. What's going on? Hashem teaching liars here? Rabbi Yochanan said, the Gemara says, Medubar beruchos shel Navot haYisraeli. This is the spirit of Navot. Now, this is one more proof of many that I've been telling you for years. How do you know that without the oral Torah, you cannot understand one verse in the Tanakh? The entire 24 books of Judaism have no meaning without the oral explanation. If you read it only the text, what impression you get? That Hashem is supporting lies. Ah, if you want to kill a wicked person, you're allowed to be a liar. Which, by the way, technically, if there's no other way, you're allowed. If you want to kill a Hamas terrorist who come to kill your children, and the only way to bring him to the trap when he's going to blow his head off is to tell him a lie. Oh, your sister is calling you. Mustafa, over there. Over there, Ahmed. Someone wants to give you a job. And he goes there and the explosion. Of course, you're not going to get punished for the lie. Mitzvah to destroy such a murderer. Which is, by the way, true. But in this case, that's not what happened. We need to know what happened. So even if it was true, there's no sin here. You can go and lie, no problem. But listen good. Hashem, the Gemara say, what does it mean that Hashem, there's one extra word in the verse that Hashem said. Why did Hashem say tzeh? If Hashem say go to Achav and put a trap in front of him, of course I have to go there. You don't have to tell me go out. The Gemara say, tzeh mimchitzati, I don't want to ever see your face again. Get out. Why? Sheneemar, dover shkarim lo ikon lenegged enai. You are here in heaven. You already know that this whole world of material, it's all illusion and lies and nonsense. And you want to go and take revenge against the one who killed you and sent you to heaven instead of running and kissing his feet? And you still want to lie? You're in the world of emet, and you still want to go and lie? Get out of heaven. I don't want you here. Unbelievable. That's what Chazal said. Semim chitzati. Get out of here. Don't want anyone like you near me. Gemara, not me. What can I tell you? It's shocking. Really shocking. You know, it says like this. Vayashkem Avram baboker. Avram got up early in the morning. El ha-makom asher amat sham. To the place where he was standing there. Et penei Hashem. Standing the face of God. The Gemara say, what does it mean standing the face of God? Doesn't have a literal explanation for it. Or what does it mean, the language? The answer is, Amida, every time it says standing, means standing in prayer in front of Hashem. That's why we call the prayer of Shmona Esre, Tfilat Amida. That's why it's the most part of the prayer. When you stand, Hashem Sfatai Tiftach Ufi Agit Tehilatecha. Open my lips and let my mouth say your praise. That's why the Gemara in Masechet Brachot, the Gemara says, Brachot page 6, the Gemara say, Ikar HaTfila, Tfilat 18, the main thing in the Tfila is the standing, Venikre Tfilat Amida. Standing, the part of the Amida. You know, we have a say, Atov shebarofim lageinom. The best doctor expressed to hell. It's very offending. Wow. Doctors give their life to save patients. There's some doctors, you know, they even don't charge money. They like you, they don't charge. They know you're poor, they don't charge. They know you're a rabbi, right away they waive the fee. They know you learn in yeshiva, they don't waive the fee. So, why these kind of doctors will go to Gehinnom? What's going on here? There's some doctors, even Gehinnom, it's a picnic for them. They deserve much worse. I'm not saying no, but most of the doctors are good people. Why? Just because they make fortune doesn't mean they're criminals. And they don't make fortune anymore like they used to. The health insurance cut their head off. And now with the Obamacare, who knows what's next? The next demonstration in the White House, I have a feeling will be doctors. You know, after this Obamacare will kick in. So Chazal say, in Masechet Kiddushin, page 82. Atov shebarofim lageinom. Best of the doctors to hell. Nobody understood. The Torah say clearly that if you're sick, you have to go to the doctor. Sheneemar, verapo irape, rapo irape, mikan, the Gemara say, mikan shenitna reshut larofe lerape. The Gemara says, how do you know that you're allowed to cure a sick person? Maybe it's against God's wish. God wants him to die in suffering. He wants him to suffer for 1 month and die. That's the end that God designed for him. Why do you interfere? Why you give him antibiotic? Why you transplant some kind of an organ from someone? Let him die. Why you take a kidney from a healthy person and put it inside his body? Hashem wants him dead and you go and extend his life? It's a very strong question. If without the Torah telling us, maybe we would not have, by the way, you should know that if we did not have this in the Torah, if the Torah didn't tell us that the doctor has permission to cure, we were not able to cure. Why? Because when there is a doubt, if to do or not to do, if I do, maybe it's a sin. Maybe I interfere with God's plan, he's going to get very angry at me. And if I don't do, he's going to die. Since I do not know, it's a 50-50 argument. There's 50% logic to hear, 50% logic to hear. What's the rule? When you don't know where to go, right or left, you stand still. You don't move until the doubt is clarified. You don't gamble. I'll take this side. No. So we would not be able to do. So we have to sit still and the patients would die. The only reason we have hospitals, these doctors, is because the Torah say, Verapo yerape, the doctors have permission to cure. Still, I'm the top authority. I'll decide who live and who not. Well, you can go to doctors, no? So what's the problem? Why they go to hell? They're good messengers. Let me give you the reasons now. Doctors, they have few problems that is very hard to overcome. First one, after many years of taking care of the patients, they already get used to see them suffer. They scream, they give them the... screaming doesn't bother them anymore. They got used to it. Every day, 20, 30 cases like this, they got used to it. People die every day in their hands. He goes out, he eats his sushi, 2 minutes later with the Chinese sticks. 2 minutes ago, somebody died in your hand. This Jew, this poor Jew, this rabbi just died. What, you go and you eat as normal? I see it every day. What do you expect? I'm never going to eat? So what? Now I'm never going to eat from now on. Or there's another problem. What's the problem? When they finally save someone, they take the credit. We did that, we did that, we worked very hard, and we saved, we were able to stabilize the situation of the patients, and thanks to this and this and this that we did, it's back to life. Which is true in reality, they did all that. But really, who gave him life is Hashem. That's it. But they take the credit. But I saw something else here. Doctors that are praying, they're praying for Parnassa. Hashem, send me lots of customers. What do you mean, send me? A doctor in Israel, a doctor in Tel Aviv. Dear God, business is slow. Send me lots of customers. So they're constantly cursing the nation of Israel. Constantly. Why? Because they want money. Fine, they need to live. Well, who's going to pay for the Mercedes? The MD on the plate. So he says, send me customers. Send you customer. Tomorrow Moshe becomes sick. Yitzchak becomes sick. So he wants customers. But we still have a question here. Why atov shebarofim? Why the best of the doctors? Why just not say the doctors? And that's it. We got the point. Why it's a tov shebarofim? Chazal never say an extra word. A tov shebarofim. It's a good question. Why? Who goes to save life? A simple, ordinary doctor or the top one? The top one. Not everyone does brain surgeon, heart surgeon, you know, surgery. Only the top of the top. If it's 30 doctors, there's 2, 3, 5 that really handle life and death. The rest, they pray for, is an allergy doctor. No problem. Yes, send me customer. 10 Jews got some rash on their hands. Allergy. Nobody dies from it. Few kids got cold. They give them some cold medicine and fine, they're good. These kind of doctors, They don't go to hell. Why? Even they pray for customers, they bring a curse to many people. But what kind of curse? No big deal. He has fever. This one has stomach virus. Whatever. But the best doctor, when they pray for customers, the power, it's not a joke, the power of the prayer is so strong that they get customers. Which means they actually increase the midat hadin on people. Not that these people didn't deserve to die. We all deserve to die. One chilul Shabbat intentionally, we deserve to die already. No, at least once in our life we did it, all of us. So we already living what a complete gift, 100%. All the Jews, all the goyim, there's not one that can say, I live here because I deserve it. Not one. The goyim, as soon as they steal, they deserve execution. Find me one goy never stole in his life. A penny, nothing. It's not possible. Jews, chilul Shabbat, 80% mechalel Shabbat in cars, so there's nothing to talk about them. And us, the ones who keep Shabbat, one time you clean a dot, a stain on your tie, that's already deserve execution. That's it. So bottom line here, we all live with chesed. Chesed Hashem. So now Hashem wanted to give us more chance to make tshuva. But because they pray so hard, it's not enough they make 2 million a year. They want more. Ah, Hashem, business is slow. Who's going to pay for my golf vacation next month? We have a lot of expenses. 7 houses. In each house he has the maids, this, the driver. You know. He needs to, so he prays, he's under pressure. He doesn't want to, you know, default. That's why they bring curses constantly. So what's the solution?
Not to pray like this.
Huh? I'll tell you a story, it will knock you out of the chair. You know, there is Chevrat Kadisha. Chevrat Kadisha, the burial service. So, in Israel, many years ago, one of the managers of Chevrat Kadisha, he made demonstration. When he came to the cemetery, and he said, today, no one will get buried. We're on strike. No, I don't allow any funeral today. The bodies, the cars of people come, the members of the family, they want to bury the bodies. He doesn't want to open the gate. He has the key. So they told him, why are you upset? He said, the city, the town, does not keep their word. We made an agreement. He said that after we make the renovation here in the cemetery and put a wall and lights and all these things, they will supply us at least 10 dead people a week. And they didn't keep their promise. He doesn't want to open the gate. In reality, maximum we have 5 cases every week. It's not enough for business. You got the point? So I guess the solution is like this. If you take a doctor, and you tell them, doctor, you know, you're having surgeries every day, life and death, life and death, life and death, every day. We have 2 questions for you. Answer yes or no. What's the first question? Do you prefer that no one would die and you won't have a dollar income? Or you prefer that people would die and you make millions? They have to check one of the 2 boxes. If he's going to check the box that no one would die and I stay without an income, he's dismissed from Gehenom. Don't worry. This Gemara doesn't apply to him. Why? He doesn't want anyone to have it. But, maybe in front of you, we're embarrassed to check. I'm talking anonymously, on an internet survey. What would you choose? This or that? If you choose the box, of course, let them all die. What do I care? I want my millions. Or even if he thinks in his mind like that, Hashem knows it. Gemara in Kiddushim, page bet. That's why it's dangerous to be a doctor. Mechanics, they pray that cars will break. Car wash people, they pray that there will not be rain. No? Rain kills the business. They want snow. Snow makes white all over the cars. You know, the salt. I knew an owner of a car wash. He said, Mizrahi, maybe you pray for some snow this week. One time, I said, why you like snow? No, pray for some snow. I said, why you like snow so much? He said, you fool, what snow? I like business. Snow, right away, all the taxi and limousine standing here online. I said, why? He said, because they have a rule. You want to work for our company, whenever it's snow, if you begin to have white marks on the car, you must come to the car wash. I make thousands in a day of snow, extra. So he prayed for snow. No, people would break their legs, people will fall. He doesn't care, he wants business. It's okay, he doesn't wish for anyone to die. But the doctors, there's no in between, my friend. But only a tov shebarofim. You got the point? We'll see you next Monday. Shavua tov.